Welcome students. Today we are going to start with a new chapter, and that is healthcare of the community. As you know that there are various levels of healthcare. The first level of healthcare is primary healthcare, secondary healthcare and tertiary healthcare. We have had a brief discussion about these levels of healthcare, and today we are going to see some more details about primary healthcare. Primary healthcare, you all are aware of the definition of it. It is a healthcare which is essential, made universally accessible and affordable through full participation of the community and at a cost which is affordable for the country to sustain. So this is the definition of primary healthcare, just in short. The whole definition is very big, but what you see on your slides right now are the important components of that definition. So essential healthcare made universally accessible and acceptable through full participation of the community and at a cost which the country and the society can afford at each stage of their development, that is basically primary health care. Remember, we had discussed some important issues with primary health care. We will be elaborating on those points now. What are the components of primary health care? The components of primary health care are education concerning prevailing health problems and methods of prevention and controlling of these health problems. So basically health education about existing problems. Promotion of food supply and proper nutrition. Remember, this is also a component of primary health care. Although it is not regularly the doctor thing that you do, promotion of food supply, but it is a component of primary health care. Adequate supply of drinking water, maternal and child health services, immunization services, prevention and control of locally transmitted diseases, appropriate treatment of common diseases, and provision of essential drugs. These last points feel like they are something to do with the medical field, from the maternal and child health to the provision of essential drugs. What you might get confused with is the promotion of food supply and proper nutrition and adequate supply of drinking water. Remember, that is also a function of the primary health care. Now again, we come to our old school thoughts. Do I need to know this? Do I need to remember this? You don't really need to learn them step by step, but sometimes a simple question can be asked, which of the following is not a component of primary healthcare? And it is for these simple questions which really test your memory, and nobody is a perfect memory. So what we do is we try to keep this in mind, and therefore I emphasize on what is the odd one out so that you should know, and most likely you will have a question on that. So what can be the question framed as? The question can be, what is the odd one out, or which of it is not a component of primary healthcare? And you might have four or three components out of these and something which is not included. So therefore, these are the components before you. Principles of primary healthcare. They are equitable distribution, community participation, intersectoral coordination, and appropriate technology. So these are four pillars of primary health care. Each one of them is very important. So the first one, equitable distribution. When we had seen something called as social justice, we saw that health service is a basic human right. There is a glaring disparity between the health status of developing and the developed worlds, and this is not a good thing to have. So what we want is, we want everybody to have a uniform health status. At least everybody should have a uniform access to the health facilities in each country. So say for example, in India, we want that the rich and the poor both should have equal access to the health facilities of the government, and that is the essence of equitable distribution of primary health. The second one is community participation. We saw some issues when we don't involve the communities. If the community is not taken into confidence, they don't participate, the program fails. So community participation is an essential part of primary health care. Their felt needs are to be known and address has to be done to those needs. So community participation is essential for primary health care. Intersectoral coordination. This comes everywhere. Any points you see, you will see there are some medical points, but there are many non-medical points such as sanitation, water supply, food supply. These are not proper doctor jobs, so to say. So therefore, intersectoral coordination is important so that all those sectors which are involved in the healthcare of the community come together and work together. So you should have the finances with you. You should have your engineering measures, environmental control, and no doubt your proper medical measures. So all these sectors primarily there are many others, should come together and work, and that is mentioned under intersectoral coordination. Appropriate technology. Now there is a complicated definition of appropriate technology, but just the very basis of it is, appropriate technology is a locally available technology which is cost effective, which makes use of the local resources and is acceptable to the people for which it is meant. So that is appropriate technology. So making use of appropriate technology is the fourth important principle of primary healthcare. Remember, these are very important. You may have an MCQ on them. If you are giving some other exams, you may have other questions on them. If you have an SAQ, you might be having a question on them. These four principles are very important for primary healthcare. Coming to the healthcare services. In India, we have five major sectors providing healthcare services, and those are public health sector, which includes primary healthcare, PHC and subcenter level, hospitals and health centers, which are CHCs, rural hospitals, district hospitals, specialist and teaching hospitals, health insurance schemes such as ESI, Central Government Health Scheme, and other agencies which have their own health hierarchy. So you have defenses, you have railways, they have their own health systems within themselves. The second category that is working in India is the private sector that we know. Private clinics, nursing homes, GPs, these are all the private sector. The third system in India is the indigenous system of medicine. Ayurveda, Unani, homeopathy, and a lot of unregistered practitioners. Now you might be saying, why are these included here and is it not contradictory so that we take them into confidence? No, it is not at all contradictory. In fact, again, we have so much of gap between the demand and supply of medical facilities that we have to take everybody on board. We have to take help of everybody. So this is also called as AYUSH, by the way. Under NRHM, this is called as AYUSH. And AYUSH is an acronym for all the indigenous systems of medicine. And these people are also recruited into the PHC. We will see that while we see the distribution. And they are also utilized for delivering of the health services. So remember, these are indigenous system of medicine. We know that, but they are also included in the service delivery of primary health care. We already saw some of the chief voluntary health agencies. We saw Red Cross, we saw Hindkush Nivaran Sangh, we saw a couple of others, CARE, and lastly we have the national health programs which operate. Coming to the most important part of all these things, village level primary health care. How is it done at the ground level and how is primary health care functioning? For all practical purposes, it is almost 99% sure that you will be having only questions on primary health care. So what you really need to know is primary health care, and that is what we are going to see. Here also, there is a huge problem that the healthcare is not simple, it is very complicated. There are a lot of hierarchies and there are a lot of job functions for each level. A lot of budgetary allocations, trainings, and a lot of formulas, and a big mumble jumbo. So what I have done is, I have cut through all that. I have just put hard facts and figures which would be easy to remember and which are frequently tested. So you have content in front of you which is testable and therefore important and therefore presented. So you have the crux of the whole thing in order to optimize your effort. Because before examination, I don't want you going through all the job descriptions of everybody, because that would be a sheer waste of time. So therefore, here we go. Schemes operational right now under the primary health care at the village level are the village health guide. And the village health guide is adopted under the village health guide scheme. This would not be a problem because the name of the scheme itself says what it does. So the village health guide is available in the village under the village health guide scheme. The second worker at the village level or the grassroots level is, when we say grassroots level workers, these are the workers we are talking about. So the second worker is the local DAI, and the local DAI is given by the rural health scheme. So local DAIs under the rural health scheme, village health guides under the village health guide scheme. Anganwadi workers are under the ICDS scheme. Anganwadi workers under the ICDS, and the last but not the least, in fact the important one, the ASHA. The ASHA is appointed under the National Rural Health Mission or the NRHM. Now coming to the village health guide. Village health guides are mostly women. They are permanent residents of the village. They are preferably educated up to 6th standard. They devote 2 to 3 hours of service for the community. The village health guide should be accessible to the society. The training of the village health guide is done at the PHC for 200 hours. Stipend of 200 rupees for 3 months is given for the duration of the training. And after that, honorarium of 50 rupees per month and drugs of 600 rupees per annum are given to the village health guide. Target for the village health guide we have is 1 village health guide per 1000 rural population. So that is the target we have. The second peripheral worker is the local dai or the traditional birth attendant. We saw that it is placed under the rural health scheme. 30 days training with stipend of rupees 300 is given for the local dai. She has to conduct at least 2 deliveries under the supervision of the health worker female. So that is her training. She has to conduct at least 2 deliveries under the health worker female. And the target of a dai is a dai per village. A village for ease is defined as a population of say randomly 1000. So a dai per village or a dai per 1000 population. The next peripheral worker was the Anganwadi worker. Anganwadi worker we saw was under the ICDS scheme. The target of an Anganwadi worker is again 1 per 1000. What I would like to do is club workers which are 1 per 1000 because there are a lot of workers which are 1 per 1000. The expected frequency of these workers should be 1 worker per 1000 of total population. Training of 4 months is given to the Anganwadi worker. They are part-time workers, not full-time, and the salary is the maximum. So maybe you want to know this. 1500 rupees per month is the salary for an Anganwadi worker, which is the max about the rest of the workers. Coming to the sub-center level. The sub-center level serves a population of 5000. What is posted at the sub-center level? A male and one female health worker are posted at the sub-center level. There is also a provision of one voluntary worker. The voluntary worker has been made optional, and sub-center level functions for maternal and child health, family planning and immunization. So these are the functions of sub-center. Basically they deal with maternal and child health, family planning and immunization. Sub-center level for 5000 population. Now coming to the composite slide I was talking about, this is something you want to know. The suggested norms for the centers, and on the right hand side you see the population. So you want a sub-center per 5000 population, you want a PHC per 30,000 population, and you want it only for 20,000 population in tribal areas or hilly areas or areas which are difficult to access. There are norms for other things also, but by far the PHC is very important, and therefore I have given both these figures. Per 30,000 population PHC in all the normal areas, if the area is difficult, it is hilly area or it is a tribal area, then you want a PHC in 2000 population. So that these are the norms for PHC. CHC, you can have a CHC for about 80,000 to 1 lakh population. So for 80,000 to 1 lakh population, you have one CHC. These numbers are expected to be known because they can be directly tested in the examination. PHC, the establishment of PHC was done as per the declaration of the Alma Ata, and we already saw the population that is served by a PHC. Now the staffing pattern of the PHC. One medical officer is posted at the PHC. One Ayush is also proposed. Like I was telling you, integration, this is starting. So we have a provision of one Ayush medical practitioner at the PHC, one auxiliary nurse midwife, one health worker female, one health educator. There are two health assistants. There are two clerks, one pharmacist and one lab technician. So these are the staffing pattern of the PHC. Functions of the PHC are medical care, MCH and family planning, safe water and basic sanitation, prevention and control of locally endemic diseases, collection and reporting of vital statistics, education about health, national health programs, referral services, training of health guides, health workers and basic lab services. This list sounds a lot like the primary healthcare component, and therefore that is true. Okay. What a primary healthcare center is delivered, is expected to deliver, is basically primary healthcare, and therefore you can see that most of the factors are an exact match or somewhere in between. So you see that those lists, it would serve you well to at least have an idea of that, because the functions of the PHC go very much hand in hand with the objectives of the primary healthcare. What are the minor surgical procedures to be done at the PHC? It is expected that a PHC can perform a vasectomy, a tubectomy, a medical termination of pregnancy, some minor surgical procedures and basic pediatric care. So this much of service is expected from a PHC. Coming to the community health centers or the CHC, these are bigger centers. So these are bigger centers, CHC. 80,000 to 1 lakh population, we have one CHC. What do you have in the CHC? You have one block health officer. There can be an MCQ. Who amongst these is not a medical person? So this block health officer is not a medical person. Although he is probably the senior most person there, because if you see the job requirements, those job requirements say that he should have a program experience of a couple of years at least, and therefore he's a senior person, but he should not necessarily be a medico. So block health officer is that post. Surgeon 1, physician 1, obstetrician and gynecologist 1, pediatrician 1, anesthesiologist 1, a public health expert, and one ophthalmologist per 5 CHCs. This is something, an ophthalmologist seems to be a rare species, so therefore he is catering to 5 CHCs. Since he is the odd one out, maybe you should know him well. You should also have a dental surgeon, 6 MBBS duty doctors, out of which 2 should be females. So that is a sub criteria there. 6 MBBS duty doctors who are posted at the CHC, 2 out of those at least should be females. 1 Ayush practitioner in the CHC also, and you should have 19 nurses. There are a lot of other lists also. You should have a driver, you should have a mason, a plumber and whatnot, but those are not important and maybe they won't be tested and it is impossible to learn them as it is. So I have put the list which matters to you. In all probability, you would have a question if you have one on these and not those rare drivers and clerks. Coming to the hospitals. Hospitals, as you know, give preventive, promotive and curative therapy. There is a specific catchment area. Having said that, it is not necessary that patients come from that catchment area. In theory, you have a catchment area of a hospital, and a hospital has both medical as well as paramedical workers. Coming to the CGHS insurance. This is a list of the services that is offered by the CGHS insurance, which is central government health scheme. You have OPD care, supply of drugs, lab and X-ray investigations, domiciliary visit, hospitalization facility at government, specialist consultation, pediatric consultation, antenatal and postnatal care, emergency treatment, supply of optic and dental aids, and family welfare services. Does this remind you of something? Reminds of employee state insurance. All those services almost common. What is the odd one out though? This supply of optic and dental aids. So maybe you would want to remember this well, because supply of optic and dental aids is specific. You can have a question which offers you a third service which is not included in the CGHS. The rest of it are again sounds like a lot of primary health care components. Suggested norms. A composite slide here for you showing the category on the left hand side, and on the right hand side you see the suggested population. Remember, all these numbers are suggested population. They are not children, they are not mad. They are very simple indicators. The denominator always consists about general population. The MCQ may trick you by giving you the denominator per live births or per children. All these parameters, even if she is a trained birth attendant, we have to see that per population or per general population. So that is one small trick they can play. They can change the denominator. So don't get fooled. All these suggested norms for these health workers are based upon the general population. Let us have a look at what those norms are. One doctor should be present for at least 3,500 population. Nurses, 1 per 5,000 general population. Male health worker and female health worker, 1 per 5,000. Trained DAI, we already saw, 1 per village or 1 per 1,000. MHA and FHA, that is male health assistant and female health assistant, 1 per 30,000 population. 1 per 30,000 population, that is a huge number. So maybe you want to know that. Lab technician, 1 per 10,000. Asha, 1 per 1,000, that is per village. Health guide, 1 per 1,000. And Anganwadi, 1 per 1,000. So who are the people who are 1 per 1,000 here? The trained dai, the Asha, health guide and Anganwadi worker are the workers which are expected there to be 1 per 1,000 of general population. So that makes your job simpler. Coming to the Universal Health Insurance Scheme. Universal Health Insurance Scheme is a Government of India scheme. It is a completely centrally sponsored program. It is meant for the economically poor sections of the society and is applicable for the age groups of 3 months to 65 years. Very intelligently, less than 3 months is excluded. But the Universal Health Scheme is applicable for 3 months to 65 years of age. It caters for medical reimbursements. Now again, you have a very long list, so I gave you the numbers that really matter. Hospital expenses up to 30,000 per family are reimbursed under this scheme, Universal Health Insurance Scheme. Accident cover for the head of the family is 25,000 for death benefit. So if the head of the family dies in an accident, 25,000 rupees are given to the family. Disability cover of 50 rupees per day. If there is a disability occurring, 50 rupees per day will be payable under this scheme. It is a family floater scheme, which means these medical expenses, 30,000 that you have, can be spent on the head of the family or any other member of the family. So collectively you have a cover of 30,000. It is not a cover of 30,000 per head. Collectively, everybody in the family, not exceeding 30,000. So that means that it is a family floater health insurance. And the government will pay 100 rupees for the BPL families. So we don't want to tax the BPL families, and therefore the government pays 100 rupees on behalf of the BPL families. What is the premium of this universal health scheme? The premium is, for an individual, it is 1 rupees per day. So if you want to take the scheme, you'll have to pay 1 rupees per day, which means 365 rupees in a year. For a family up to 5, you'll have to pay 1 rupees 50 paisa per day. And for a family up to 7 people, you will have to pay 2 rupees per day. Remember, the minimum premium in universal health scheme is 1 rupee per day and the maximum is 2 rupees per day. With that, we switch over to a new topic, the MGDs, or the Millennium Development Goals. This is recent, has been started testing, and it is expected that it will be tested in future. So you definitely should know this. Millennium Development Goals. I have written the target here. MGDs are to be completed by the year 2015. So what are these MGDs? There was a Millennium Summit conducted in New York, and 189 countries ratified the UN Millennium Declaration. That was called as the Millennium Development Goals. These are goals in the area of development and poverty eradication. They place health at the heart of the development. So now that is important. MGDs represent the commitments of governments through the world to do more. MGDs are an integral part of the roadmap towards the implementation of UN Millennium Declaration, and they assist in the development of national health policies. So these are in general about the MGDs. What you see in front of your slides right now is the 8 MGDs that you have. You have goal 1 to goal 8. I will be reading them out and we will be seeing them in specific. The first goal is eradicate extreme poverty and hunger. So that is the first goal on the list. And what do you mean by eradicating extreme poverty and hunger? We want to reduce by half the proportion of people living on less than a dollar per day. We also want to reduce by half the proportion of people who suffer from hunger. So that is the goal number 1, eradicate extreme poverty and hunger. Read this goal so many times that you know that this is a goal for MGD. This is really important. Goal 2, achieve universal primary education. Under that, we have ensure that all boys and girls complete a full course of primary schooling. So primary education is compulsory, and in India, again, you should know this, primary education is compulsory. It has been made compulsory for everybody. Goal 3, promote gender equality. In that, we have eliminate gender disparity in primary and secondary education, preferably by 2005 and definitely by 2015. So gender equality by 2015. Goal number 4 is reduce child mortality. Reduction by 2/3 in children under 5. Goal number 4. Goal number 5 is improve maternal health. You want to reduce by 3/4 the maternal mortality ratio. It would serve you well to write this down. Reduce by 3/4 the maternal mortality ratio, and regarding the child health, we said by 2/3. Child health by 2/3 and maternal mortality ratio by 3/4. Achieve universal access to reproductive health by 2015. So that is improved maternal health. Goal number 6 is combat HIV/AIDS, malaria and other diseases. What you want to do is halt and begin to reverse the spread of HIV and AIDS, and halt and begin to reverse the incidence of malaria and other major killer diseases. Goal number 7 is ensure environmental stability. Integrate the principles of sustained development into country policies and programs, and reverse the loss of environmental resources that we have induced. The other thing is reduce by 1/2 the proportion of people with sustainable access to safe drinking water. The other thing is reduce by 1/2 the proportion of people without sustainable access to the safe drinking water. Goal number 8 is to develop a global partnership for development, which is international collaboration, sponsorships, youth exchange programs and things like that. Also, we want cooperation in pharmaceutical companies, provide access to affordable and essential drugs in developing countries. We are going to see the health systems in India. What we are going to do is we are going to see the important structures. Not many questions are expected out of this portion, but you may get one odd MCQ or you may not get any MCQ. At the center, we have the Ministry of Health and Family Welfare, in short called as the MOHFW. You have then the DGHS, which is the Director General of Health Services, and you have the Central Council of Health and Family Welfare. So this is the infrastructure at the center. Regarding the Union Ministry of Health and Family Welfare, the organization consists of Cabinet Minister, Minister of State and Deputy Health Minister. There are basically two departments in the MOHFW, and they are Department of Health and Department of Family Welfare. Remember, you have a separate Department of Family Welfare. The functions of the MOHFW are, there are two lists, basically Union List and Concurrent List. In the Union List, you have International Health Relations, Medical Education, Census, Drug Standards, Research, Administration of Central Institutions and Labor Laws. That is the Union List. The Concurrent List is Communicable Diseases, Adulteration of Foodstuffs, Control of Drugs and Poisons, Collection of Vital Statistics, Labor Laws, Ports and other major ports across the country, Population Control and Family Planning, and Economic and Social Planning. So these are the functions of the top level, that is the Union Minister of Health and Family Welfare. We come to the DGHS, or the Directorate General of Health Services. Its functions are International Health Relations and Quarantine, Control of Drug Standards, Medical Store Depots, Postgraduate Training, Medical Education, Medical Research, Central Government Health Schemes. You have National Health Programs, Central Health Investigation Bureau, Health Intelligence and National Medical Library. So all these functions come under the purview of the DGHS. Third, we have Central Council of Health. It works for cooperation between the states as well as the center. So the Central Council of Health negotiates between the health of the states and the center. Functions of the Central Council of Health are provision of health, health legislation, grants to the state, and cooperation between the center and the state. So these are the functions of the Central Council of Health. At the state level, you have State Ministry of Health and State Health Directorate. The State Ministry of Health, you have Health Secretariat and Deputy Secretariat. And at the district level, you have subdivisions which are under the administrative control of the collectors. At tehsils, you have the tehsildars. Then you have the community development blocks, followed by larger municipalities and corporations. At the grassroots level, you have villages and panchayats. Under the Panchayat Raj system, you have Gram Panchayat, Gram Sabha and Nyaya Panchayat. Now, because this is grassroots level, sometimes a question can be asked, which of the following is not a body at the panchayat. So remember, you have Gram Panchayat, Gram Sabha and Nyaya Panchayat. These three are present at the grassroots level under the Panchayat Raj system. You have Panchayat Samiti, and for a Zilla you have a Zilla Panchayat. So that was in brief the health system of India.